Welcome to chapter 7 of this massively open online course. My name is Stefan Shimura from the Helmholtz Center Dresden-Rossendorf, where I'm an expert in the investigation of nanoparticle fate in the environment using radiochemical methods. In this chapter, I want to introduce you to the use of radio tracers for nanosafety studies in the laboratory. First of all, what are radio tracers? Radio tracers consist of atoms whose nucleus is unstable due to excess of mass, protons, neutrons, or energy, so-called radionuclides. These radionuclides transform into stable nuclides under the emission of ionizing radiation. That can be the emission of an alpha particle, which is a helium nucleus, a beta particle, which is an electron or positron, or the emission of gamma radiation. Of these decay radiations, the beta and gamma emissions can easily leave and be detected outside of the sample. This makes them suitable as radio tracers within about up to 10 half-lives of the respective radionuclide, after which almost all the original radionuclide has decayed, producing no detectable signal anymore. Now that we know what they are, where do we get them from? Radio tracers are typically produced via nuclear reactions using either a cyclotron, a small particle accelerator that can accelerate protons, deuterons, or alpha particles, or a nuclear reactor. Radio tracers can be produced via irradiations or isolated from the fission products in the case of the nuclear reactor. Typically, as a user of radio tracers, you won't be involved in these processes, but get the radio tracers from the cyclotron or reactor crew, or use commercially available radionuclides that then can be introduced into the nanoparticles to trace them. The introduction of the radio tracer into nanoparticles can be achieved by methods that are so diverse as chemistry itself. Here I try to break them down into five principles. We can, of course, perform a total synthesis of the nanoparticles using radioactive starting material. Or we can bind the radio tracer to already existing particles using a suitable chemical reaction. Another method would be the in-diffusion of radionuclides into surface defects at elevated temperatures. Or in case you have access to a cyclotron or nuclear reactor, the activation of the particles via proton or neutron irradiation using suitable nuclear reactions. If nothing else works, one can also attempt the so-called recoil labeling. Here we use the recoil of a nuclear reaction triggered by proton irradiation to implant the radio tracer into the nanoparticles. For any of these techniques, it is imperative to make a detailed characterization of the resulting radio-labeled nanoparticles. You want to know if the radio-labeling process changed the particle properties and if and under which conditions the radio label is stable. Since in your later experiments, you only track the radioactive atoms, you need to know that they stay where you want them to be, i.e. in the particles. If you have successfully gone through the process of obtaining a radio tracer and to radio label your nanoparticles, you have several modalities of detection that can give you a variety of different information on where the radio tracer is in your system. Without going into the detail of the technicalities of how a certain detector works, here you can see different detection modalities in order of increasing dimensionality of the obtained information. The simplest information you can get would just be the quantification of the amount of radio-labeled substance in a specific sample. Using inline detectors or column scanners, you can detect breakthrough curves in transport experiments, or deposition patterns alongside a column. Methods such as autoradiography will give you a quantitative 2D image of the tracer distribution, typically with a 50 to 100 micrometer resolution. And using, for example, positron emission tomography, you can obtain detailed spatiotemporal distribution data of the radio tracer, albeit at a higher resolution of about 1 millimeter. All of these methods can detect the radio tracer over several orders of magnitude at minimal concentrations down to the femtomole scale. Of course, using radioactive materials comes with some safety precautions. However, when following these basic rules, you can perform radio tracing experiments safely in a controlled lab zone. The rules are keeping of distance, the minimization of the handling time and amount of radioactive material, the use of proper shielding. You can see the lead shielding in the lab image on the right, and the prevention of incorporation of the radio tracers, which is to say to follow proper chemistry lab conduct. Typically, actual radio tracing experiments will take place at very low activities that can be easily conducted in a safe way. And with that, I want to conclude with a few words about why you actually should use a tracer that is in need of special precautions and will decay during your experiment. The reason to use radio tracers is the unprecedented sensitivity of detection, the selectivity of the detection, and the possible complexity of the measurement, in the sense that you don't need to care actually about your complexity of your system. For example, you'll be able to selectively detect a specific radio tracer at minimal concentrations in such complex matrices as sewage sludge, basically without any sample preparation necessary. With this, I hope to have made a strong point for the usage of radio tracers, especially in nanosafety research, and want to direct you to the next chapter, in which I will try to illustrate the use of radio tracers through specific example studies to give you an idea how the theory looks like in practice. With that, I thank you for your attention, and for further information, please have a look at our website and the social media. Thank you.